We're still in the drug section of the course. We're still looking at evidence in terms of, we did a little bit with instrumentation, but at this point we're really talking about the chemical evidence. You know, what are the drugs and the extracts and the excipients and things that go with drugs. After this portion of the course, we'll get into physical evidence. So the glassware, bottles, blasting caps, and things like that. So today we're talking about meth, heroin, and diverted pharmaceuticals. And so the chemical evidence left behind from these different drugs of abuse. Now part of that is a legal curiosity, and that is, can you get off of a crime by saying, oh, well, that's cocaine, but cocaine's complex. The form I have isn't really a drug. You know, I've got this RS or this different types of chirality. And so we have to get into the chemistry of the different types of molecules. So isomer is not a clear enough word. There are different types of isomers. There are constitutional isomers, meaning they have the same constitution in terms of number and types of atoms. And an example of that is like dimethyl ether and ethanol, right? They both have two carbons, both have six hydrogens and one oxygen, but they're not the same molecule. But they have the same molecular formula. Okay, so molecular formula is not good enough to tell you what substance it is. It could be ethanol, it could be dimethyl ether. So that's one type of isomer. Then you have the stereoisomer. And from that you have diastereomers, which are like cis-trans isomers, and other kinds of diastereomers, which have two or more chirality centers, and then enantiomers. And so this chirality is something that we'll look at a little bit this morning. So it's just a bit of review. And here's ephedrine that has two chiral centers. Cocaine has four. And so these molecules can get pretty complex in their different forms and how they put together. So do you remember the convention of priority from organic? Did they beat this India pretty hard? Yeah. Do you remember this? So you put the hydrogen, if it's got a hydrogen, you put that back, the lowest priority in the back. Mm-hmm. And then you look in terms of the heaviest atom, and you just look to see if it goes in a clockwise or counterclockwise manner. Okay, and Rex and Links or Sinister and so on. You look to see if it's an R or an S isomer. So here's an R enantiomer. You see it's going clockwise, 1, 2, 3. And here's an S, it's going counterclockwise, 1, 2, 3. And this priority decreases with mass of the attached atom. Okay, and so this is the first priority, the first attached atom, this is the heaviest, is a nitrogen. Now, if they were all three carbons, you'd go to the things attached to those carbons. And so here's nitrogen, so that's the first priority. Then these two are carbons, and so how do you break the tie? Well, this one has a bunch of mass added to it, this one doesn't. So then that's the next priority, and then this is the third priority. And so this is clockwise, and so this particular chiral center is R. This one, put together, the same molecule, put together a different way, and now you have an S. So S methamphetamine for this chiral center, an R methamphetamine for this chiral center. And then you can look at this chiral center if it's been turned, if you put a methyl group on this one of these hydrogens here, then you can have an RS chiral center at that carbon. So you have RS, SS, RR, SR. And so which one is the drug? Well, they all have some inebriating effect. And so in the law, you can't be so specific to say only the RS is a drug of abuse. Okay, so they broaden the law to say that that you can have any of its different enantiomers or any of its different forms. Okay, so they'll write the code broad enough so that you capture all of these. But in the crime lab, you may want to, for some reason, I don't know what the reason might be, but you may want to characterize it in terms of the various components. Now, characterizing this would be a little difficult because they're going to have very similar mass specs. There might be slight differences in its fragment pattern, but it's going to be difficult because it's exactly the same molecule, bonded in the same way except for chirality. Okay, so all of those bond energies are going to be almost identical. The only time you might get a different bond energy is if one chiral center has a slightly different steric hindrance than another. And so you might have a situation where if it's RRR, then the thing wraps around and bumps into another part of the molecule, whereas RRS, it's not as bad. So you might get a little bit of a difference in fragment pattern if you have a steric hindrance, where it's easier to fracture one bond versus in this form versus that form. So So that would be a very fine characterization of a particular substance, but you might be able to tell the difference between different origins of these different molecules. Now, alkaloids. These are plant extracts and their derivatives. So the opiate alkaloids are in the milky latex. So any kind of sap or milky extract from a plant is called latex. So latex paint, what's that about? Well, it's from the rubber tree. It was natural rubber. And so latex paint, the polymer that held that paint together, was natural rubber. And so that's where the latex and latex paint came from. And so it probably still has some of those natural components in it, but now it's more of an engineered substance. But that's where the name comes from. And now latex paint essentially means water-soluble paint. And so it'd be latex versus oil-based. So the word's kind of gotten broadened in its use when it comes to paint. But in terms of plant materials and alkaloids, latex is talking about the extract from plants. So this is a poppy seed pod. And if you scratch that poppy seed pod, then you end up with this milky substance. You let that dry a little bit, and then you scrape it off with a knife. But then, you know, it's pretty amazing. 7 kilograms of raw opium per 1,000 square feet of poppy field. So that's quite a bit. You know, now it's obviously a labor-intensive process, but they have folks that go out into the fields to harvest this, and then they collect it. Now, I think closer to the end of the video, it talks about sort of quality control and making sure these people, if they work a certain shift, they need to have a certain amount that they turn in to keep them from pocketing some in another bag or whatever and selling it on the black market. So there's quality control at the source to make sure that there's not two markets. But somewhere, there's two markets. Okay? Somewhere this stuff gets turned into sort of black market heroin and so on. So it's well regulated, but then somewhere along that regulation trail towards legitimate pharmaceutical use, there are some exit ramps to black market use. Now that milky latex is pretty potent, 10% morphine in this substance. You dry it out, the concentration just goes up. You're sort of concentrating by evaporation. Now these opiates, again, that 10% is morphine. There's a couple of other things that are in the latex by themselves, codeine and thebaine. Just look at the chemical differences. They have the same kind of fused ring structure, but it's really this position 3 and 6. You can have OH groups there, which makes it morphine. You can have one OH group and one methyl ether, which is codeine, or two methyl ethers, which is thebaine. Then the semisynthetics from these, you can take codeine and put an acetyl group on there, react that OH group with acetic acid, and make acetylcodeine. Or you can reduce it, oxidize it, take that hydrogen off, and make oxycodone. So you've heard of oxycodone. And then you've got morphine. If you acetylate it in both those positions, then you have heroin. Diacetylmorphine is heroin. So you've reacted with acetic anhydride and created diacetylmorphine. Now, if you react it partially, then you have this monoacetylmorphine, or 6-monoacetylmorphine. If it's in the 6th position, or in the 3, or both. If it's both, it's heroin. If it's in the 6th position, it's 6-monoacetylmorphine, or 6-MAM, or 3-MAM would be in the 3 position. So the simplest reactant to use is refluxing it with acetic anhydride. And the 3 position is the most reactive. So this is formed first. 3-MAM is formed first. And then it's diacetylmorphine. You react the 6th position and then you have heroin. Now, because the 3 position is more reactive, it gets deacetylated first. And so then if you have 6-MAM, then what that is old heroin. So it's heroin that's reverted back to monoacetylmorphine in the 6th position. So the first to be acetylated is the 3 position, then you have diacetylmorphine, and then it's deacetylated. The hydrogen is back on this oxygen, and so then this is sort of old or aged heroin. It's an important process for you to look to see if this is fresh material, fresh heroin, or old heroin. Because if it's in a humid environment, you know, this is essentially hydrolysis. You take this ester and you add a water one oxygen goes with the acetic acid, the other, and it leaves a hydrogen back on that oxygen, it makes an OH. So it's the reverse of an ester reaction. Now, once you have heroin, if it's on the black market, you've got to get it into the country where you're going to be selling it, and you can use mules. So that's a common practice for human trafficking. You want to get into the United States, that's fine. We're going to get you into the United States, but you got to do something for us in return. You got to swallow these balloons filled with heroin. And then when you get into the country, you poop them all out, and then they sell the heroin. So this is an x-ray, and you see in this person's stomach and intestines these little balloons. So there's one right there. It's like a capsule, which, you know, is two vertebra big inside an intestine, so it's a piece like that, which is this, like, I don't know how many times a lethal dose of heroin. I mean, if that balloon breaks, this person's dead. But it's not like they're worried about the person's well-being. They just want to get the drugs into the country. But that's what some people are doing just to get into the United States and maybe other places, okay, is taking these basically drug shipments inside your body. Your body is the shipping container. Yeah, it's pretty sad. But anyway, that's and it's an enormous personal risk, too, because that capsule would kill you. And this person has several inside their body. Now, once you have these drugs in a crude form, there's many different ways to purify them. This is, again, liquid-liquid extraction in this case, or just cold filtering. I'm really pleased, actually. There's some controversy right now with YouTube deciding what videos are suitable for the public and so on, and it sort of gives them a lot of power, right? It's their private network. But they're going in and they're, you know, tightening up on what they think is suitable content. But one of the benefits is, for years there was a video that I had for some high school kid, I kind of talked about it last time, separating codeine from Tylenol 3 in his, basically in his living room. You know, who knows where the parents are. And I clicked the link, it's in the notes that you guys have, but I've changed them because I clicked the link last night to see if it was still active, and it wasn't active. YouTube said this content has been removed, you know, for dangerous content. So it was basically acknowledging, hey, this kid's teaching people how to pull codeine out of over-the-counter formulation, and we don't think that's cool, so they shut it down. So in that sense, I'm happy YouTube's doing that. I'm not happy when they like pick a political side and censor the opposing side. That's overstepping the bounds. They're a private company, they can do it. So if we have this heroin and it's mixed in with dextrose, cornstarch, other kinds of things, you know, how do we get it out? Well, you can put it in water, and the starch is less soluble, make it cold, and you can do a cold filtration. And so the insoluble stuff you could filter out, you could examine that to see what it is under a microscope. Starch will form for hexagonal patterns when it crystallizes. You can look to see what kind of starch it is. You can do liquid-liquid extraction. So in this case, heroin is a base. Let's go back to the molecule and see that basic nitrogen. And so if you put it in acid, it's going to be ionic. And ionized substances are soluble in organic or aqueous phase.
I didn't hear.
Ionized substances. So if you put it in an acid, it's ionized. And that's going to be aqueous or organic soluble? Yeah, ionized is aqueous, right? Because it's a big old positive charge. Mm-hmm. And you're not going to be very happy as a positively charged molecule in an organic solvent, right? I mean, organic solvents may have a dipole moment, but they're not going to hydrogen bond with you. You're just not very welcome in an organic solvent. But you get into water, you get a solvation cage of water. Water stabilizes ions very well. And so if you put this base in acid, you're going to protonate it, and it's going to go to the aqueous phase. Okay. If you put it in base, you're going to drive it into the organic phase. And so that's what they're doing here. They put it in an aqueous phase and wash it, get it all into the solution, then put it in contact with the chloroform layer, and make it basic, and so then the free base heroin goes into the chloroform layer, and you can then take that off and run it on confirmatory tests. You can put it in an IR or a GC or LC. Here's the tropane ring, that's an alkaloid, a cocaine, various versions of cocaine. And so here's that tropane ring when I put stars on all of the chiral carbons. And you can see all the different chiral carbons. It also has a basic amine. And so cocaine, again, you make it basic, you protonate that base, and you're going to make it ionic, and it's going to go into the aqueous layer. You may see pseudo-cocaine or allococaine or pseudo-allococaine. What's the difference between all of these? Well, if you just look at the structures, they're all the same except for the chiral centers. So here we're talking about equatorial versus axial positions for this acid ester. Okay, and so you've got this one, both of these are in equatorial positions for pseudo-cocaine. They're in axial positions for allococaine. One's in equatorial, one's in axial for the pseudo-allococaine. So just different ways of putting them together in those chiral centers will give you all of these different cocaine derivatives. And so again, we sometimes have to look at the purity of the cocaine, because some of the penalties depend upon the purity. And so you can use GCMS to separate all of these, and you might get a slightly different fragment pattern based upon their chirality. Yes, and so sometimes they'll say, you might have 5 grams and it's not that pure, or 5 grams is really pure, it's a higher penalty for the pure stuff. Why would that be? Well, let's say you have stuff that's almost 100%. You're probably not selling that. You're probably going to take that and divide it and sell it. So it's really worth at street value a lot more if it's pure, because you can cut it and sell smaller packets. So. It's not going to be a difference, I don't think, of like 5% versus 6%, or like 5% packets versus 95%. Those would carry a larger penalty. Here's again some more extraction schemes to purify the substance. Why am I showing you all these schemes? It's not so that you can purify cocaine. Okay. But think about the chemicals related. So you've got somebody that's not just got cocaine, but they've got a lot of chloroform in their garage. Okay? They're not just a user. They're not just a reseller. They're actually participating in drug manufacture. Okay? And so again, higher penalties, more counts against them. And you're actually taking somebody that's not just a twig on a tree, they're more of a branch in this whole black market of drug use. So, you can lop off the twigs, but you still got the branches. So if somebody's actually manufacturing and distributing, then you're actually cutting off a branch and making it more difficult for folks to get the drugs. So here's a couple of different paths. You can take that cocaine, if you take the leaves, so this is one way to get it straight from the leaves. You've got dried, chopped cocoa leaves. You can put it in base first and extract with an organic solvent. So remember, this is a basic molecule, so if it's in a basic aqueous solution, it's going to look like this. It's going to be neutral, and so it's going to be soluble in the organic solvent. And all of the other aqueous junk, okay, is going to just be other stuff that came out of the leaves. And you don't want that, you just want the cocaine. Now there'll be other organic substances in the cocaine that go into the organic layer, but all the water-soluble stuff will be in the aqueous layer, and you can throw that layer away. Then you put it in with another organic solvent, and you add acid, okay? And you drive all of the other organic junk into the organic layer, and this is protonated, so it's in the aqueous layer. So you've sort of thrown away the aqueous-soluble stuff while the cocaine was in the organic layer, and then you put it in with another aqueous layer, change the pH, it moves into the aqueous layer, and all the organic junk that you don't want is now in the organic layer. Cocaine's moved across that boundary and is in the aqueous layer. You throw away the organic layer, so you've shifted it twice. You've separated it from other aqueous stuff, and now you've separated it from other organic stuff. And so then you add base again, and it's in the aqueous layer, and you add base, and so you deprotonate it. What's going to happen now? You're not putting it with another organic layer. So you've got cocaine, and it's in aqueous solution, and you now change the pH where the aqueous solution is basic. And now you have a neutral organic molecule and a basic aqueous layer. What do you think? What do you think will happen?
Precipitate.
Yeah, it'll precipitate. Okay, and so if you do it slowly, it'll grow nice, beautiful crystals.
Crashes out.
Okay. Yeah. If it's quick, if you like, just dump. If you make it basic by just dumping concentrated sodium hydroxide in there, it's going to crash the pH and it's going to just come out and you're going to have tiny little crystals. But you're also going to trap a lot of impurities. Okay. So if you do this quickly, you get a really impure precipitate. It's the kind of probably it's going to be a yellowish looking powder. But you filter that. And so then you have this cocaine base, which is a paste that you filtered out of the aqueous solution after making it basic. So you may want to clean that up. And so doing one more recrystallization step, you can get a nice white cocaine powder. And one of the ways they do that is just any organic solvent they can find. So kerosene, gasoline, you know, white gas, Coleman fuel. Now these are cheap organic solvents. They're also pretty dirty, but you know, again, you get it back up into organic solution because it's a neutral molecule, and then you salt it out of the organic phase with an HCl generator. So we'll look at those in a second. Let's go down the other path. What if you take those leaves and you put it in with sulfuric acid? This is going to be protonated, and it's going to go into solution because it's now water soluble. And as a sulfate salt, so it'll be protonated and there'll be a counter ion of a sulfate running around. And that's going to be in water. And then you put it in contact with an organic solvent, so again in a separatory funnel type thing, where all the other organic molecules that ended up in the acid will move to the organic solvent if they're less soluble. And then you throw away that organic layer. So this is still in the aqueous layer. Then you can add base and crash it out and filter it. So this one, you just do one extraction. You just put it in contact with one organic layer, pull the organic substances out, and then you crash the cocaine out and its other water-soluble components into a paste. And then recrystallize in kerosene. So let's talk about this recrystallization. You've got the substance. It's a basic molecule. It's neutral. It'll dissolve in the organic layer. And then you bubble HCl in there, and it makes this ionic substance with the chloride counter ion, and that forms crystals in the organic solvent. So you can crystallize it in organic solvent, it'll make a ionic crystal with the cocaine HCl derivative. So these are various, this will be more physical evidence of a chemical process. So these are physical exhibits, propane tanks with extra piping adequate, a gasoline tank with a hose strapped to the top. This is like a mustard or sour cream bottle, so you can get it at the dollar store with some Tygon tubing from Ace. You just push it on there. And what are you going to put in here? We're going to have a whole lot of salt in this container. Like maybe looks like the bottom quarter of it is just table salt. And then you're going to make that just slightly acidic, and it's going to just push HCl through that hose. You stick that down into the kerosene, it has your cocaine dissolved into it, and you'll start to see crystals forming. And so this is an organic solvent that does not want to stabilize ions.
Yeah, right,
so those ions do not want to be in organic phase.
I gotta make sure I have all these notes down.
What's that?
Yeah, write this all out, make sure you know them all.
Yeah, so if you see a sour cream container and it's got a ton of salt in it, you're like, that's weird. You know? This is not a salt shaker.
That's interesting.
Yeah, that's interesting. Now, by itself, again, you got some kid like my son Thomas who's goofing around in the garage. Okay? But if you've got other paraphernalia for clandestine drug use, then that gives you, then it's another evidence exhibit. So what, as a lab chemist, what are you going to have to verify? You're going to verify that that's sodium chloride. Okay. What are you going to do that? You know, you're going to put that in the GC. Right? So there's going to be different ways to verify these different things. Okay. So these are HCl generators. It's a common practice for clandestine labs. Mostly for meth production because methamphetamine is also a base. So they'll recrystallize that in gasoline and then salt it out with an HCl generator. But remember Le Chatelier's principle. Salts, sodium chloride and HCl are extremely soluble in water, but you can push this reaction to the left by adding more chloride ions. So you just totally saturate it with sodium chloride, and you're going to start generating HCl gas. And so then that you can build up a fairly decent pressure of HCl gas in this container. And you can actually smell the HCl a little bit in some of these swimming pools. Like you're in a salt pool, you still kind of smell a hint of something that burns your nose. That's HCl. Chlorinated pools are stronger. You really smell it then. So then you just bubble that in, and you'll salt out the crystals. So there's some other alkaloids and even some synthetics. So LSD, you're not going to find in a clandestine lab because it's a multi-step synthesis. Who's in integrated? There's like a multi-step synthesis in there that nobody tries because it's nearly impossible. So did y'all even do a two-step synthesis in organic? Do you remember?
I think we did. Yeah. I think we'll...
So a two-step synthesis, you do a synthesis and then you take the product of that synthesis and you use that as a reactant
and follow along. We did.
Very difficult. Why?
It didn't work.
Because it's yield times yield. So if you have 50% yield, yeah, you script the first week, you're toast. Yeah. So 50% yield on the first week, and then now you have, and you have 50% yield on the second week, overall it's 25% yield. Mm-hmm. And that's pretty good.
Or zero, for us.
Yeah, or zero, yeah, or 0.01, you know. So multi-step syntheses are difficult. So you need someone with really good organic lab hands, and you need... you know, a good source of fairly large amounts of initial material because you're only producing a small amount. After you take all those steps, their yields are multiplied by each other. So if they're all 25, so it's a quarter, now you're down to an eighth, and so on, or a sixteenth even. And so this is LSD, again, not really a homemade substance. Other alkaloids are extracted from various things. Fungus, cactus, and mushrooms. So the things that we do in our body. But again, these hallucinogenic effects are apparently like the guy that tried LSD, he was the discoverer of it, tried it in the extreme. He called it his problem child. So he was addicted to his own study material. He had severe crises and demonic transformations and psychological episodes. And also, some of the LSD, the history that I've heard, is that you can have flashbacks later when you aren't even taking the drug. So then you start having paranoid episodes and hallucinations when you're not on the substance. You'll even get that with severe meth addiction. So if somebody is, they call it tweaking. Have you heard this?
Yeah.
So they're always, they're twitching and so on. Sometimes they'll hallucinate that they have bugs on them. So they'll be... you know, having an episode of sort of a psychological hallucination. Now, there's different types of hallucinations. There's we think of visual hallucinations. So that's one perception channel, which is your visual cortex. But there's also like sensory or tactile hallucinations. How many people check their phone thinking it vibrated? Yeah. Right? When it didn't. I did it all the time. But that's a tactile hallucination. I just hallucinated. It's like I felt like my belt vibrated. So what was that? You know, no, it wasn't my phone. You know, it must have been my stomach. I'm hungry. You can even have auditory hallucinations. So you hear something that wasn't there, and you can have olfactory. I guess you know all your senses can be fooled.
I had the olfactory after I did the body farm,
mm-hmm.
and I showered. It was like a mm-hmm. day later. I was laying in bed.
Oh, and then the smell hit you.
I was like,
yeah, I'm sure it had to be a strong smell, you know, for you to know, okay, I'm hallucinating that, yeah. Now, you can also associate things with smells and get a triggered response. This was kind of funny. There was a friend of mine in high school that had a popular perfume. I can't remember what it was called. Giorgio or something. Anyway, it was some kind of perfume that only she wore, okay? So I'm at college now. Couple of years in, so it's been a year or two since I've seen this friend of mine, and this girl walks past me the other way wearing the same perfume, and involuntarily I was walking along and went, Polly, you know, I mean, it was such a connection, and the girl turned around and was like, what? I was like, oh, never mind, I thought you were someone else, but I didn't even see her, it was just the perfume, I was like, oh, that's my friend, you know, and spun around, Polly, she was like, what? I'm sorry. Yeah, so... that wasn't a hallucination. She was actually wearing a perfume, but I didn't. So you can fool, and you can fool your senses, but if you think you're having a sense perception that's visual and auditory, and you know, a multiple sense channels, then that's extreme. Where you think you're actually talking to somebody and so on. Where there's the most extreme level of hallucination is hitting more than one sense channel. Oh, and this is, like I said, no Lofofora Williamsy. No, that's not me. No relation. So then the non-alkaloids, so the non-extract things, this phenylethylamine, the amphetamine family, it surpassed cocaine as the second most abused drug quite a while ago. And it's easy to make and highly addictive. And these are some old numbers. I started to look up some more modern ones this morning, but I couldn't find a decent site that would just sort of lump it all together. They were all based on this county or this state in terms of the meth lab cleanups. But, you know, that's a pretty big change from 446 in 91 to 10,000 in 2005. And I'm sure we've passed it. I mean, it's probably really gone up. Then we have ecstasy and its derivatives, and phencyclamine and ketamine. Again, this it was an anesthetic stolen from vet hospitals. So,
nice.
Yeah, it's kind of crazy. And then these strong sedatives. So just these ones are not alkaloids. These are pharmaceutical substances that typically are stolen. And then you have diverted pharmaceuticals. So this is a picture of the physician's desk reference that I talked about earlier. So this would be, you know, we had the confirmatory test, and then we had these sort of suspected tests or spot tests, color changes and so on. And so you have a white powder, you spray some solution on that that's going to change color if it's a narcotic, and so you get a presumptive test, positive test, says that it's probably an opioid. So that color change is a presumptive test. Well, visual examination counts as a presumptive test. So this pill is kind of greenish color and it has a V on it, and so that's a presumptive test, positive for value, because it matches right here. Okay. Now I said it was a greenish color, and here we see the importance of colorimetry. Right, because this projector doesn't give me the accurate picture that I see on the screen here, assuming the screen is accurate. And so you would want to make sure that you have, you're going to take photographs and so on, that camera with a color card in it. So if I'm going to take a picture of my pills and they're colored and I'm going to try to get colorimetric evidence, then I'm going to put a color card in that frame. And that's something that I don't see all the time, but I think it's a best practice because that's my thing, is color. And you'll see a scale marker, you'll see a number for like exhibit number. So insist on your photographers, if they're going to try to get color evidence, to have a little color card like we used in the PCHEM lab, which had, you know, red, orange, yellow, green, blue, and black and white, so that you can adjust the image to white is white and black is black and red is red. And so you can adjust the colors for the color card, and then you can get an accurate representation of the color of the pill or the substance of the blood stain or the blue jeans or whatever. And so this would be, so if you saw this color in the desk reference, you saw it in your exhibit, you could write up, and again, it would be presumptive for value. Now you would still want to confirm that that tablet isn't just a copycat, okay? Because you could press that shape and have fake substances. It could be cornstarch or sugar, okay? And it'd be a total counterfeit. Counterfeit pharmaceuticals is a big deal and a big crime. So not everything that you're going to study is going to be just drugs of abuse and people trying to get high. You know, if I'm selling you oxycodone tablets at $80 a tablet, and I can make things that look like oxycodone that are just sugar, okay? Sugar doesn't cost anything. But I can sell you these tablets that are $80 a piece, and then I move on, and you're like, "That didn't do anything for me, that jerk. Where is he?" You know, well, he's gone. You got your money, and he's gone. Okay,
exactly.
But you get this exhibit that the person is now, you know, saying, "Hey, this is oxycodone," and then you test it, and it's not. Then you've got a different kind of case. It's now a counterfeit pharmaceutical case. So you have all of these. So how would you test this? Well, taking a photograph is non-destructive, so you haven't destroyed the evidence. to test this for its formulation materials, you can scratch the side off. Now, most of these tablets are coated, so you don't want to just set the tablet on the ATR of your FTIR and take a spectrum, because you're just going to get the sort of the cornstarch or the glaze that is coating the tablet to make it strong and not flaky. So you would scrape a little bit with a spatula and get some of the powder from the inside of the tablet and put that on the IR and then run a scan. Now, you're not doing any separations. You're just getting everything. So you're getting all of the non-active ingredients. Maybe you scrape some of that, put a drop of methanol on there, and extract it to the little disc on the FTIR, and then you're getting the more of the drug substance. And so as long as you do that with a known exhibit of Valium, and then you test your unknowns, and if they match, then you've got a confirmatory test. So here's things that you've heard of. You've heard of Valium, perhaps. Here's Tylenol with codeine, so Tylenol number 3. Here's Vicodin, Darvocet, Oxycontin. So all these different types of, here's the blue Oxycontin. So different colors have different strengths. So this is 160 milligrams of Oxycontin. Here's 20 milligrams. And it says OC on one side of the tablet and 20 on the other. And this says OC on one side and 80 on the other. So there's a lot of information that's stamped onto a pill, and then you go to the physician's desk reference to compare it. This is a huge industry, as we know, fake prescriptions and so on. And so this is what got Kermit Gosnell to be investigated. How many people have heard of Kermit Gosnell? Anybody? No? It's shocking. Yeah. He's the Philadelphia doctor who was running a pill mill out of his women's clinic there in the inner city in Philadelphia. And so from chapter one, this is some of the facts that came out of it. He was in cahoots with this guy, Robert Carey, in Northeast Philly, and he forged prescriptions for over 142,428 tablets. So that's what, as they were adding up his counts, this is the total sum. At $80 a tablet for oxycodone, that was in 2009. So it's a lot of money that he was making. So this is what led to the discovery of Kermit Gosnell's pill mill smurfing scheme. So smurfs are junkies, fake patients that buy dozens of prescriptions. And so on one visit, Gosnell wrote the following for this informant, Susan. So the DEA put an informant in and started, she started going and buying prescriptions from him. And just, you know, to see, he would sell her the prescriptions that she was gathering information. And so this is just one day she went in. She got a prescription for 60 OxyContin tabs, 90 Xanax tabs, 8 ounces of fenugreek with codeine, 60 tabs of Bactrim DS, and 60 tabs of Lexapro. So that's a huge number of prescriptions. And then she would go down to the pharmacies and just get all of those filled. Now, she had a lot of different patient names. This other lady, Fiona, used 26 different patient names. And so she could go to the pharmacies and just get prescriptions for other people, right? I'm just filling this for my friend. And the pharmacist would take the money and fill the prescription. And so Gosnell would sell 200 prescriptions a night, 150 for the first one, and then $20 after that. And so, you know, even if it's 200 scripts at $20, right, that's $4,000 a night. Just selling prescriptions. He doesn't even have to sell the drugs. He's a doctor, right? And so he's just selling $4,000 a night, making a lot of profit. And all he's buying is a little tab of prescription paper, a little pad of prescription paper. Now, what happened, too, is when they went in to bust him on the drugs, they found that he was also running essentially like a back alley abortion clinic. And the scissors are related to him not bothering with doing any of the procedures for abortion, but just delivering the babies live and snipping their spinal cords with scissors at the end. Yeah. And so it's a disturbing book to read, but I recommend it. It's amazing. So that's why they call him America's most prolific serial killer. Okay. So this is what got him caught. Okay. And then they went in and
found that he was guilty of murder because he was delivering by live children. So that's, again, what kind of evidence would you find? You would find these prescriptions. You would find, you know, all kinds of this pill mill scheme would have a lot. As the lab, you would get a lot of physician desk reference type material. All of these tablets, you have to verify that a certain number of them. So you got, if you got this many tablets, let's just say these all showed up at the lab door. 142,000 tablets. What's your sampling plan?
Oh, here you go.
Oh.
yeah. So let's do it. Let's just do it. So we got. Now this. That's if these are all the same. Okay. So let's simplify. This is all the same OxyContin tablets, right?
Okay.
But if they were different ones, you'd say the OxyContin numbers and then the Xanax numbers and all of those.
And then assign it to different.
Yeah. 142,428. So minus 20. So you test the first 20. 142,408 times 0.1. So you still have 14,241.
Oh my god.
Plus 20.
20,261.
Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah.
Well, you're gonna definitely.
But that's a lot easier than doing 142,000 tests.
But I hope one person's not doing all of
it.
What's that?
If that really happened, would you? And they were all the same tablet.
That's probably where you would go to the GUM, guidance on uncertainty management, and see if there was a better scheme. So if the thing we're doing is just the rule of thumb.
Yeah.
You know, the rule of thumb is test the first 20 and 10% of anything above that. But that may still be too large of a number. It's huge. 14,000 tablets.
Yeah. That could take forever.
But obviously, this would be an enormous seizure, right?
Yeah.
And so it would be a big deal. So you may want to do that just to make sure it's stuck, okay? But in this size, you're going to have a group of OxyContin tabs and a group of Xanax tabs and Valium and all these different things. And you would treat each one of those seizures separately. And so you'd have a smaller plan, but it may still end up adding up to something substantial like this. You may get credit for saying, okay, we tested a certain number with confirmatory tests, and then we took photographs of all of them and said they all appear to be the same. So then you may not need to do the full confirmatory testing on 14,000 tablets, but may take pictures of 14,000 and say, look, we've got presumptive tests on all 14,000, and we tested at 10% of those and got confirmatory tests. And we didn't see any evidence of counterfeiting. So they were actually the drugs. Yeah. So, but again, you would want to document all of that and all of your decisions that you made, and then, you know, see if the prosecution was happy with that. Yeah. So pretty interesting stuff. So we're still on the drug evidence. Next section of notes after this test will be on the physical parts of it all. So all the physical evidence.